Parental discretion is advised.
This show is brought to you by Slice on Broadway, supporting Pittsburgh podcasting with the perfect pepperoni pizza, sliceonbroadway.com. And listeners like you, support this show at patreon.com/wrestlingmayhemshow. Just wait, just wait. Hey guys, it's the Wrestling Mayhem Show. I'm at Sorgatron in Mayhem Studios here in Pittsburgh, PA, less than 3 miles away of the site of the infamous Hell in a Cell between Mick Foley and The Undertaker. That's right, right here in Pittsburgh. With me, also part of Mayhem, we're Mayhem Worldwide here today. Worldwide. Okay, it's just Pennsylvania and Texas, to be honest, but we're coming strong with Texas. First of all, Eamon Payton, the voice of Inspire Pro Wrestling.
I'm a little sunburned because I am beaming with excitement. Get it? No, I'm serious. No, I really can't feel my face.
Well, it's nice knowing you on the Wrestling Mayhem Show. We'll see you next time, Eamon. also with us from the greater Pittsburgh area as well is The Riz. Riz plays games on the Twitter.
The way you started off that part, Eamon, is probably one of the best ways you can start. You can say, I am beaming with excitement, with zero excitement, and that just broke me, sir.
Can you believe
you just had a smile and just the monotone of voice? I am beaming with excitement.
Can you believe? And this guy,
I'm so happy.
And this guy commentates on professional wrestling. Just putting that,
people ask me to do a job for shows. Up to multiple hours.
Holy crap. And also joining us from California, PA, it's Hot Wheels leading the way into our hearts and minds here. Hot Wheels RWA, sound guy from the Renegade Wrestling Alliance. This is the part where you say something.
What's up, people? I'm feeling a little global. What?
Wheels is on the way.
I say people.
Oh boy, this is going to be a fun one. Also join us, also from Texas. This one from El Paso, Texas. He's from thewrestlingrevolution.com. Antonio Garza.
I have no puns. I don't know what to say.
Okay. But this is your Wrestling Mayhem Show. We talk about pro wrestling. We talk about the mainstream stuff, the pro wrestling. We get a little more into the details, into the weeds on some other shows. So many shows at WrestlingMayhemShow.com. You can go over there, subscribe to this and everything else on the iTunes, Stitcher, Spreaker, iHeartRadio, YouTube, Facebook. Please, video, audio formats, share them wherever you like to have them shared and tell the people about the Wrestling Mayhem Show Nation. You can also drop us a line. We love hearing from you guys, 412-206-WMS0 or good times.
Good times.
Good times
at WrestlingMayhemShow.com.
Honestly, that was the best one we did.
Yeah, it was good. You guys were like, it's almost like you guys mm-hmm. didn't have any sort of internet delay and we're actually like in the same state, but you know. No, you can join us, become part of the conversation and enjoy that as well. You can also join us here live every Tuesday night, live.wrestlingmayhemshow.com. We got a bunch of people joining us here. Juggalo John, our good buddies, Bobby FJ Town, Mad Mike join us. Mad Mike on the tweets tonight, I do believe. And of course, wife of the show at Rebellious Flaw or at Wife of Mayhem, on the Twitter is helping us with the show notes as well. Is that Matt Carlin's out there as well? Hello, Matt, our friend in the mainstream media, join us in the chat room. You can also please, if you like the show, if you dig the show, I know we're not deep enough for you to make a determination, but we want to recognize the people that do support the show monetarily at the patreon.com/wrestlingmayhemshow. They get apparently a half an hour of extra content that we don't share on the feeds usually, including results from the March Mayhem, which you can go vote now or very soon on round two over at WrestlingMayhemShow.com and look for that little button that says March Mayhem. It's our brackets to determine the best match ever. So please go check that out. We had a good start for just kind of kicking it off and beta testing it. But anyways, our Patreon supporters, thanks to our friends, Bo Diggity!
Woo!
as well as, hey, this guy in here, the Patreon in the bank holder himself, Antonio Garza, I think the longest Patreoner, Ed Burke as well, and the Jennifer and Matthew Carlin's Foundation for Podcast Betterment. Got it. So thank you so much for all those guys for supporting the show. It means a whole lot. And you don't have to give money to the show. Just share the show and or rate on iTunes. It goes a long way to help out the show. And I know there's a lot of new eyeballs on the show these days, and we really appreciate you guys checking us out. Let's get into it. Let's get into my pop screen falling, apparently. Okay.
Oh, no.
Everything. It gave out. It couldn't take any more of the mayhem. Holy crap. Hold on, I need to fix this now. So, there was some interesting news this week. I wanted to get on some not WWE stuff as I try to fix this thing. So maybe I could toss it to somebody else. So the big news this week was actually about TNA.
And Jesus.
Did they get bought out yet?
No, not yet. Wow, this thing just kind of failed on me, didn't it?
Okay. Give it time.
All right.
Throw it away, Sorg.
Sorg, we all have those problems. No,
I went to take from the Patreon money and buy a new one now. Okay.
It's okay, buddy.
Am I allowed to? Garza, am I allowed to get a new pop screen?
Sure.
All righty. There you go. That's his call. That's his call. But no, of course, a friend of the show and Eric Young, we actually interviewed Eric years ago, an early friend of the show. He was still in TNA because he's been there that long. He's actually been in TNA.
God, well, now that I think about it, if I have the date right, like close to 10 years ago, we interviewed him.
Probably, actually. It's well into at least maybe our second or third year, maybe we talked to him. So we should give him a call. We might have his.
Maybe his number's still the same.
If his number's still the same, I might have it somewhere and be like, hey, Eric, Wrestling Mayhem Show. I know it's been a while.
Before he signs to the big company.
I know. No, you have. Yeah, you're kidding me. You absolutely remember us. But no, him and Bobby Roode, leaving the company. Gave their notice to their last parts of the recordings, the tapings this past week, of course. So you'll still see him for like a month, I guess, on the shows. But they'll probably also be on NXT at the same time because that's how it goes. This is significant because they're like. These two guys, I think collectively, are the sting of the company.
Mm-hmm.
I guess you could have said AJ Styles was the sting of the company originally, but these are, I mean, these guys were there for the long haul, and I don't think it ever left at any point during their tenure there with TNA. And I don't want this to be another death knell of TNA. I kind of more want to think about what can we do with Bobby Roode and Eric Young at this point? Eric Young, you know, as a lot of the articles saying, has been an absolute chameleon over the years, playing every role possible in the company. Tuning back in the TNA a couple months ago and seeing he was this like madman right now was pretty fantastic too. You know, the guy is super talented, and it'd be amazing to see what he does in another environment in. Any environment I can think of, I think both these guys could flourish in. What do you guys? Garza, you're typically the TNA defender here. How are you feeling about this initially?
I'm actually okay with this. I think they both been in TNA so long that they have nothing else to do, and I think it's good for them to try something else. And I think it's actually good for TNA to, I mean. Probably aside from James Storm, they were probably some of the ones that were getting the most money. So, you know, if TNA can save that money and hire like another tag team and an expedition guy and a knockout, hey, by all means, TNA, the only way they can survive, they can maintain themselves alive on Comatose is by bringing in younger people who can like give excitement to their divisions. So I'm okay. I wish Bobby Roode would go to Ring of Honor in New Japan because there are just so many dream matches that I've been wanting for the last 10 years. But I think we all kind of know that he's probably NXT bound. And same with Eric Young. I feel for Eric Young because he's probably going to become the Santino Marella of NXT and eventually WWE. It kind of sucks because he's a guy that I always love when he becomes really serious. So But I mean, I think it's one of those news where I just try to see the positive, and you know, it can help both sides.
Mm-hmm.
I agree, and I definitely agree with the aspect of like the fact that I hope that they kind of do find their stuff kind of elsewhere. I think you said Ring of Honor. I think the New Japan would be great fits for either of them. People, I think, are automatically defaulting to them going to WWE. And I think we've seen with James Storm that that's not always guaranteed. He was there for a cup of coffee, and then he kind of left. Yeah. And I don't know if he was like the test to kind of see if like TNA guys would kind of work there. I think they, I mean, people pop for him because they were in Florida, and you know, Florida, and the NXT crowd and TNA crowd are still very similar, like as far as geographically wise. But I don't know if they have long-term staying power in NXT or WWE necessarily. They are guys who I really always liked in TNA. However, I always had that background fear of, like, I don't really like a lot of wrestling in TNA. So I don't know if they're, like, good for TNA, so to speak. You know what I mean? Like, I think we're seeing an influx of you know, international and independent talents in NXT right now that are performing at a level to where you kind of have to perform to that level in order to be considered anything. We're kind of seeing that with guys like Elias Sampson right now, who is a solid wrestler, but isn't to the level of like the independent names that they bring in, like that they kind of advertise and bill as like top stars. And I feel like Bobby Roode and Eric Young could fall into that. I hope the best for them, obviously. But I don't think anything's necessarily guaranteed for them when it comes to WWE.
You know, when you mentioned that, I just wanted to say real quick, those guys are kind of old right now. I think Bobby Roode is like around 39.
Yeah.
I don't think they would like just drop TNA not knowing there's something else that they can do right now. So I think there's only talks.
Garza, you and I are like this right now. We are combined because I just pulled it up. Bobby Roode is 39. Eric Young is 36. So they still have some tread on their tires.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, but to see with those ages, you got to sit there and think, what do they have to offer WWE that WWE would want them? So,
yeah. I mean,
that's the problem.
I would say guys like AJ Styles are around that age. However, AJ Styles was brought in and then immediately brought up to the main roster as a big deal. If they're going to have these guys go through NXT, which I would think they would have to, I don't know why you would just bring up Bobby Roode and Eric Young as like guys, you know what I mean?
Right.
Particularly when at least you could mention, like you can mention that AJ Styles did this stuff in New Japan Pro Wrestling and he was a top independent name, so to speak, and was like kind of the face of the indies.
They cannot mention that
I was going to mention
TNA.
I was going to say, if we're going off the Edge and Christian show, they're not going to mention TNA. Like they aren't. I just find, I don't know, I think they're kind of in a place. I think a company like New Japan Pro Wrestling that has been known for taking talents that kind of didn't make it in like a mainstream sort of level in the U.S. and making them stars in Japan, I think they would find it a really good place for them particularly. Or another topic, I would love to see him in Lucha. You know, I think particularly someone like an Eric Young who's so great at character work, I think he could fit perfectly well in Lucha. But yeah. Also, complete side note to this whole story. I'm sorry, James Storm. I'm gonna come back to reform this tag team, and then my tag team partner leaves where I left.
Yeah, I find it weird that happened.
It was probably his fault.
Yeah.
I mean, he's now getting like more money than he was getting in NXT. So obviously, guys like Eric Young and Bobby Roode are gonna be like, "Well, maybe we can get that money too." But oh, guess what? We don't have enough money. So, too bad.
Yeah. And the sad thing is, Like, I agree with you guys on, I'd love to see them in New Japan or even Lucha, but strange enough, and I could see it easier that they'd probably end up in Global Force because of Jeff.
And it's a lateral move.
Yeah, it's not a step forward. Yeah.
Why leave TNA to go to TNA?
TNA without TV.
But an even less guaranteed TNA.
Yeah.
They're
hunting money, and like that's a smart thing for them because they're all, like we said, like they don't have many years left in the gas, so they need to secure the best job that they can at this point. That's why I think that they didn't leave TNA without already knowing that there's a like foot in the door for NXT. I mean, NXT already has AJ and Samoa Joe and Austin Aries, and they all vouch for Bobby Roode and Eric Young, I'm pretty sure.
Especially Bobby Roode.
Yeah. I was going to say, Roode's going to have a better chance in NXT or the main roster because he has that look and that style that maybe WWE could handle.
He has an it factor.
Exactly. Jesus.
That's what it says on the title.
I kind of want to step to Garza's earlier point. Like, I kind of want to see that Ring of Honor or New Japan thing because I think AJ would completely be an NXT candidate if he went directly from TNA. I think it's the New Japan relationship that got him over with WWE and over to WWE because obviously they're really kind of it feels like they're raiding New Japan a little bit, doesn't it? They're really kind of just scraping their top guys out of there for NXT.
And there's allegedly more to come, possibly.
Yeah, and I don't know. Like, I don't feel like New Japan. I feel like there's definitely enough talent in New Japan. I don't think they're in trouble, for instance. And I think New Japan is getting something out of this in the long run. I don't know what that is just yet, but there's definitely a relationship just really directly there. So it's not like, you know, maybe better than the ECW, you know, relationship, for instance, but it's a bigger company in general.
Plus, WWE now has their own kind of feeder system for NXT, which is Evolve.
Right.
With their cruiserweight title tournament cruiserweight tournament thing, they're going to start. Yeah. At Evolve.
So do you think they didn't say, they said some qualifying matches there, right?
Yeah, just the qualifiers are at Evolve.
Couldn't it be interesting if they also announced maybe eventually, speaking to my previous point, New Japan will also hold some qualifiers?
Well, I think, because I believe the way they phrased it was that the American qualifiers are at Evolve.
Mm-hmm. There you go.
So.
And don't they have some sort of relationship with one of the companies in Mexico?
New Japan or
WWE?
I don't think they do.
You don't think they do?
They have taken some talents from that area, though.
I mean, they've had tryouts with both AAA and CMML, but
okay.
I don't think there's like an actual relationship.
Okay, but maybe they could be for this or something.
I mean, they're going to bring in guys from Mexico.
Right. Definitely. Right, certainly. It'll be interesting to see what they do there, and I don't think they have an India presence necessarily other than their touring, like TNA was trying to do over there. So,
other than William Regal and then whatever Sword. His name.
There's that guy. There's that guy.
Hi, Sword.
As Kali.
Yeah, that guy's not cruiserweight.
Wow.
No, I'm not.
Wow, I hope
he eats cruiserweights. But...
That reminds me, I hope Riz didn't watch Edge and Christian this week. They were not nice to Great Kali. Why are you giving me Great Kali crotch? That's weird.
Because, Sorg.
No, you're just showing us his one bad knee.
Which is both.
Yeah.
Wow. All right, on that note, hey, I want to give shout-outs to our friends at Slice on Broadway, supporting Pittsburgh podcasting with the finest pepperoni pizza, and now also supporting the Pittsburgh Pirates at PNC Park.
Hey,
that's right. They're not just here in Beachview along the tracks. They're about to get ripped up in a week. They're not also down in Main Street down in Carnegie, PA. They're also at PNC Park, the home of the Pirates. So you can get a slice down there when you're visiting. Or if you're CM Punk and Colt Cabana coming in town to watch their Cubbies knock us out of the playoffs, they can get some slice on Broadway as well. And I hope they do the next year.
I was there for that, Sorg.
Huh? You were there for that? Did you encounter a Colt or a CM Punk? While you were
I did
there.
Not.
No.
They were like, they had a lot better seats than us.
Oh, of course, because they are who they are. If you ran into Colt Cabana or CM Punk at that game, what would you have said to them?
Unblock me, CM Punk.
Hashtag unblock me, CM Punk. Hashtag unblock me, Colt Cabana. By the way, Colt Cabana, thank you for unblocking
us. Colt Cabana likes me, so we're cool.
That's good. Oh, that's good. He's a swell fellow.
Boom, boom, Colt Cabana.
You know, sorry, I know we're in commercial, but when his music hit, when he came out for IWC and I had it on the headset, and I'm like, oh, it's time for the podcast to start. Oh, shit, the match is happening. So I kind of had a weird where am I moment, you know. But anyways, had a great match with RJ City, by the way, but we'll get to that in an indie wrestling spot later. What are we talking about? Pizza, Slice on Broadway,
pizza,
supporting
yes.
the show. A guest come in here, they eat the pizza. There's some over there. The Chilla was here for awesome casting, kept it within arm's length. It was nice. So thanks to them, sliceonbroadway.com, pgh_slice, or Slice on Broadway on the Facebook and the Instagram. Let them know you heard about them on the Wrestling Mayhem Show. Let's get back to some wrestling, guys. There's some other things that happened this week.
Were there?
Do you want to talk about this Evolve thing? A little bit more?
We can.
Is there much? I mean, it's interesting. Like, we knew something was happening. There's been appearances. William Regal went to the recent Evolve, or one of them, because they usually do back-to-backs. I saw two of them were featured in our Around the Indies that mainstream Matt Carlins does over on indiewrestling.us for us. So he came out and said that, like you said, the American qualifiers for the World Cruiserweight Championship or World Tournament, I guess, are going to start there. I like this. This right off the bat, this feels like what I used to love about the TNA World Cup.
Mm-hmm.
Right? A little bit, maybe. Like it feels like they're taking some really good elements of that, and I can't wait to see who we see pop up in this thing. You know.
Yeah, I agree. I think they've taken a philosophy that they haven't taken really ever in the WWE, which is let's recognize that there's other places that have wrestling and showcase the talents there. Like, what, you know, they kind of did that with ECW, and that was the closest thing ever that they did it to. And it's good to see. It's really good to see.
Yeah, there's this interesting spot where they get to a point where they recognize somebody that does somebody, you know, somebody like an Evolve, like an ECW, that either is okay, that's there's talent there, that, you know, that's a direction we want to go or take from, or whatever the case may be. Like, there's kind of an admittance there. And when both of these have happened, you got to think it's at a weak point in WWE's lifespan, right? That they were like, okay, this isn't working. What's going on outside our 40-foot walls at Stanford, right? And I think it's really interesting. And again, I think as always, you know, Triple H is kind of the forebearer of this thing as it stands right now, right?
Well, I think there's still underlying, like, there's still obviously some underlying stuff of like how they kind of did past business. Like, notice when like ever like. A top indie or an internet name, and I'm using huge quotation marks when I say that because I hate saying that, comes in WWE, usually the first story they do with them is you haven't done anything until you made it to WWE. Like, that's usually the first
right.
talking point. They immediately did it with AJ Styles and a bunch of other guys.
With the main roster. That's a philosophical problem with the main roster.
Yeah, I mean, we're not seeing that in NXT.
No. No, and like I talked about last night on the Raw wrap-up, like, we're taking the best, arguably the best talents out there, and we're making them annoyingly chant each other's name, you know, on Raw. Like, really, that's the best we can do with this? Yet you know we're going to get a great match at WrestleMania. I'm not worried about that. Just get me there. So there's that. And even, like, NXT respects when you come in where you came from to more. It's more of an education. It's more of like, well, let's see what we can do here. There is a little bit of... you haven't made it until you've made it into WWE, but that's more of a comment and a challenge than you are worthless, and we're going to keep telling you you're worthless until we don't anymore. You know.
Well, I don't even think it's a case of like worthlessness. I think there's like a little bit of that in there, but I think it's more a case of when you go to NXT, like there's a case of, oh, you have these character traits like Sami Zayn. You're the you know, young, up-and-coming good guy who, you know, just fights hard. Samoa Joe, you're this badass, you know, kind of guy. Finn Balor, you have this demonic side to you and stuff like that. And then when you're on the main roster, your only character trait is guy who the internet likes.
Right. There's a different... Like, you have to fit in the
like
archetype.
They're very much like, this is the one that the internet fans like. Like, wink, wink. And I don't like it when they do that, but it's whatever.
It's like they have a post-it note. Like it's kind of a... Like, they have a board, and we're like, oh, he fits under this category. And, like, they have all the roster on post-it notes. And we're like, oh, this is, you know, this. And Tyler Breeze, we just put him on top of the post-it that says Dolph Ziggler, and we treat him the same way, you know, and things like that. Without John Cena sticking up for you and wanting to have good matches with you, I guess you can't go too far with those kinds of things. So unless you're something like, and Sami Zayn's awesome, but I feel like something like Kevin Owens is such a force of nature that they can't deny him, right?
Yeah, Kevin Owens I think is the most opportunity to really shake up how WWE presents these people. I feel
right. Like kind of a CM Punk, like he, not that he's doing a pipe bomb promo, but every time he gets on the mic, he does something interesting and different. And I want to say, you know, I don't want to say captivating necessarily, but you know,
he never feels stale.
No, he doesn't. He absolutely doesn't. Even when he's doing something that's a stale storyline, as we do, like taking on Ziggler for the ninth time in a row, right? twice a week.
When he cuts like a promo on AJ Styles at that house show, where he like he only wanted to work AJ at this platform and stuff like that, which you never see a heel do. Like they always have to be, you know, an asshole. And it's like, it's cool that he's not fitting into that mold that WWE has always set out for its wrestlers.
Mm-hmm. Right. Right, exactly.
Yeah, I'm sure most of the wrestlers that are there are told not to do the things that Kevin Owens is doing.
Oh, absolutely.
In the ring, like yelling at the commentators while they're while wrestling.
No, I don't think they necessarily tell them not to do that. I think just they don't think to do that. I mean,
I think it's a little bit of a case of them telling them not to do that.
But how many guys do what Bubba Ray Dudley does? Like I watched him on SmackDown, I watched him on Raw. I love so much that Bubba Ray Dudley is yelling so much at his opponent and just belittling him in true Bully Ray style that it shuts up the commentators.
No, I agree. I love when wrestlers like communicate during matches like that.
Right. Sorry, Riz. I think I was stepping on you.
He's turning into Bully Ray.
He is, and I love it.
You can tell that because they're giving him straight singles matches.
Uh huh.
Which is against the, you know, the Usos, but still, or no, it was R-Truth.
Goldust last night.
Yeah, he had both of them. Yeah, both of
no,
them.
No, R-Truth. All right.
I think it's a case of like when I got to listen to the panel that the Lucha Underground talents did during South by Southwest, and someone brought up like the whole idea of like working for Lucha Underground and stuff like that, as opposed to like a mainstream wrestling promotion. And Vampiro was very blunt in saying like, when you go to work for WWE, you're there to be their puppet. They pay you to do what they want you to do, as, you know, and be a product of theirs and be a robot, as opposed to a place like here where you get a bit more creative freedom, and you get to perform and be creative in what you do. I think that's why Kevin Owens and like early times of like the New Day and stuff like that was so good, was because it felt like this is stuff that they were just coming up with and were doing.
Mm-hmm. Right, right. And the ones that break the mold in that, right? The Mavericks, you know.
No one told Kofi Kingston to be going, I'm not doing this as my character. Country music sucks. Like, no one told Kofi to say that. Like, that little stuff, it's like, it shows like, oh, they're actually have hands in this material. You know right. what I mean?
Right, exactly.
It's like they always say
that. Which made them so much better, and the crowd loved them. Mm-hmm.
Garza?
It's like they always say, everyone's better when you're not scripted. Like, all of these guys, even if they're really young, they grew up watching Dusty Rhodes and watching The Rock and Stone Cold and those type of promos. Like, they grew up practicing promos. Like, they can go out there and do promos without being scripted. Like, we've seen Roman Reigns, like, when he talks in interviews or when he talks, like, in the panels, like, he's pretty good. Like, the same with Cesaro. But when he goes into the like to the scripted material, like they just bomb mm-hmm. because it's not yeah. natural.
Exactly.
And, like,
so
that's kind of happening right now with the New Day. Is that there's some people being like, oh, I'm kind of down on the New Day, and I think it's because it's kind of clear that like, oh, WWE's like, okay, go out there, hit this time the times where you say booty, do the bootios thing, and then do the WW, like that thing, and just hit those spots.
But they've also found the spots.
Instead of when they were coming out having a country bear jamboree.
Right. Like, I mean, it's not necessarily, I don't think it's okay. It's hard to come up with great material week in and week out. Right. So I they've worked so hard over the last year or so with their characters. Isn't it great? Isn't it great that, you know, at a certain point, Stone Cold can just come out, hit his things. Rock can come out, hit his things, and wrap them around whatever relevant promo and not have to do quite as much work. You know, Mick Foley gets to come out and do his cheap pop bit. You know, they're to that point. I think forever the New Day guys can come out and do booty-os and WWE booty shaking and all that stuff, and that's their thing, and they have the easy pop. Don't think that it's a problem, right? They're okay. Settling into their characters now because they've been established.
Okay.
Do you see where I'm going with that?
I agree. Yeah. I could see that. I definitely could see that.
Mm-hmm.
Like, I think there was a recent Jericho podcast where I heard him talking about the whole idea of like, once you're over, you're over. You don't have to kind of do all the crazy stuff anymore. Once you're over, you're over.
No, absolutely not. You stuck your neck out there and it paid off, and now you got all the merch and everybody's cheering and you just need to show up. Hearing Pittsburgh explode just from them starting off with the New Day and hearing Big E on the microphone. They're there. Like that was a freaking Stone Cold pop. And I know it's different. Obviously, Philly was not as interested in the New Day. Or anything for that matter this week. Because Philly.
Let's not blame Philly for everything.
No.
I can't
blame
Philly for everything.
Listen, you're in Texas. You don't have hockey. You don't have ice. You don't know how it is.
I do have hockey.
You don't have ice. No, you don't.
The Dallas Stars are not a hockey team.
I don't have good hockey, but I have hockey.
You don't. I know you have hockey, but you don't have hockey, okay? We're close enough to Canada to say so up here, okay? But anyways, but no, we can say Philly sucks, and we can move on. Let's get it on to a better topic. we're here with guys that know what the fuck they're talking about in pro wrestling. Of course, Antonio Garza, thewrestlingrevolution.com. Of course, Wheels, the sound guy from the Renegade Wrestling Alliance. So he's seen his shit. He's seen some shit.
Oh, yeah.
We've got our war stories.
Crazy shit.
Everybody here has their war stories. Everybody knows. Yes. They've seen some shit. Riz.
I've seen a mother get pile driven in the ground before.
Riz has seen some shit.
Poor Riz.
Riz has seen some shit at Wheels the Show.
Yes.
He's my go-to. He's my historian for the International Wrestling Cartel over there, Riz. And, of course, Eamon, voice of Inspire Pro Wrestling down there in Texas.
Of course, Eamon.
And then there's Eamon. Mr. I got to hang out at South by Southwest. I get to hang out with Johnny Mundo all day.
South by Southwest. I'm a hippie man.
Look at his bedazzled abs.
Whole Foods, everybody. Woo.
I hate Whole Foods. Whatever.
But you can become, you can say a big fuck off to Whole Foods. And you can go.
Pre-peeled oranges bullshit? Nah.
I don't even know. You can say, and you can go over to indiewrestling.us. I'm trying so hard, guys. You go to indiewrestling.us and you can go read Main Street Matt Carlin's column that we name dropped earlier around the indies. Of course, the great Indie Mayhem Show is featured over there as well. New up there, you can. I think it still says pre-order. I didn't change it yet, but the DVDs just shipped for IWC's 15 and IWC's Proving Ground 5. RWA's Fury 2016 shipping soonish. There's a lot of stuff coming through. And of course, there's actually going to be a giant smattering of Prime Wrestling stuff going up there as well. It's been very busy around here at Sorgatron Media lately. But go, please check it out. If nothing else, you don't even have to buy anything. Just go read the thing, sign up for the newsletter. You'll get some inside info, what's going on at Wrestling Mayhem Show, what's going on in the indies in the area. Our good friends, they have releases of Vicious Outcast Wrestling as well. Old school stuff. I mean, geez, look at these DVDs I put up from a few years ago. 2011, Night of Superstars with Mick Foley and Gail Kim and Tracy Brooks and Carlito. A lot of great guys there. Seasons Beings from RWA with Shane Douglas from back in December here. Some great stuff. What was that? Ray Rowe versus DJ Zima Ion for the then heavyweight championship back in, I think that was also back in 2011 at November Pain. Go check out all that stuff. A lot of great history. A lot of other people that you're watching on TV today came through Pittsburgh, came through Cleveland. You know how much Johnny Gargano footage I've gone through over the last couple of weeks? Holy crap, guys.
Yeah, flag tight, sorry.
No. I went to, like, the first Resolution, and I think he's got a last man standing match with Gregory Iron on that, and he came out in the flag types, and I fucking popped today when I was working on that. It was great, because he was just, like, random dude with flag types that teamed with Facade when they were the tag team in IWC, but he was actually doing some shit up there. Go check out all that stuff. We're having so much fun with that stuff over indiewrestling.us, and check out the columns, information, everything. All right, we're going to check out, as usual, we're going to check in with some more Mayhem Origins from the 10-year party earlier this year at Looking for Group here in Pittsburgh, but also going to check in some good friends having a great comedy cancer benefit. So please check out the information for that. If you're in the Pittsburgh area, go buy a ticket, support the cause, and we'll be right back with the big question. And holy crap, we're actually going to do Mayhem Mania again. Here we go, guys.
Guys, it's Matt Light, Pittsburgh Magazine's 2014 and 2015 winner, best comedian, and cancer survivor. Come check me out Friday, April 8th for a night of stories, laughter, barjitsu, beer pong, and prizes that will be sure to make this a night to remember. I'll be performing with some of the best comedians in the Steel City. Portions of the proceeds benefit the Testicular Cancer Awareness Foundation. Special thank you to our event partners, FN Vodka, Ultra Premium Vodka, Pittsburgh Improv, Pittsburgh's premier comedy club, Sorgatron Media, podcast, video production, and creative media, Pittsburgh Podcast Network, for Pittsburgh by Pittsburgh, River's Edge Radio Network, Pittsburgh's voice for local music. Comedians for Cancer, Friday, April 8th at Dave & Buster's in the Waterfront, the only place to eat, drink, play, watch sports, and laugh all under one roof. Get those tickets, folks. Go to barjitsu.com or showclicks.com and search Comedians for Cancer.
Okay, well, when I first got my iPod, God, back in 08, something like that, maybe a little bit earlier or later than that, or earlier, I was watching an ESPN show, and I heard them talk about something that they have a podcast, and I'm like, what the hell is a podcast? So I looked up what podcasting was, and I'm like, oh, it's just radio shows that you can download and listen to anytime. I'm like, I bet there's some about wrestling. So I literally just typed wrestling podcast into iTunes, and I downloaded like at least, God, 5 or 6 that I just like grabbed them and started listening to all the episodes that they have available. And I think the Mayhem Show only had 3. So I'm like, okay, these guys just started. I can get in on the ground floor. And I listened to the first episode, and the first thing I heard them talk about was Lita's tits. I'm like, I think I'm going to like this show. I think I'm going to enjoy the show. Because I was at that pay-per-view the night before. So I'm like, oh, okay, yeah, these guys are all current. This is going to be great. And I have not stopped listening since.
Hey guys, Wrestling Mayhem Show, we are back. Welcome to the podcast of Too Many Mayhemers, and that's the second half. As usual, the floodgates have been opened as per the commandments of the Mayhem Mania. It's going to get mayhemy here towards the end. But first,
the chains are off.
It's time for the big question with Eamon. What do you got?
I got a big question.
Oh, wait. I forgot. Shout out to our Patreons that I forgot at the top of the show because I don't know how the new interface works. Alex Cars and Mad Mike. Mad Mike joins us on the line. We have a few new voices. Yeah. I'll try
real,
to get to them.
Real nice, Sorg. Oh. Hey, donate to Patreon. Everyone, Sorg will forget you in the intro.
This
I'm
is
kidding.
Not
really
helping.
Actually donate to Patreon. It helps the show a lot.
keep donating so I can hire somebody to keep that straight for me and whack me with this kendo stick over here. Where's the kendo stick? The kabuki stick. When I miss the Patreons, they will hit me with this kabuki stick over here.
Are you saying I get a free hit next time I'm in Pittsburgh?
Not what I'm saying. I'm saying when you have enough Patreons.
It sounds like that's what you're saying. So
when you have if we get to the point where we're getting like $100 an episode and I miss something, then yes, the kabuki stick will be in effect. That's now a pledge goal. Is $100 per episode. That. Kabuki stick will be, you don't get anything, and we don't know what we're doing with the money, but all you know is I'm getting hit with a stick. Is that worth it?
Yes.
You guys answered way too quick, even with the lag. Like, I think you beat the Google Hangout lag. That was weird. This is what happens when I'm alone in my basement with implements of violence. Eamon, do you have a big question?
Big question. Yeah, I got a big question for this week. So, we got some problems in the WWE, in particular. Probably in other places, too. There are injuries happening literally everywhere.
Every week?
Like, sneeze and someone's injured. Like, it's getting bad, you guys. We had the thing with Neville 2 weeks ago. Luke Harper's now out injured with like literally just punched a dude in the corner, torn ACL. Like that's, and I'm not even joking. Like that's how it happened. So
we're at the Zack Ryder has a WrestleMania match level.
Yes, we're at that level, guys. It's getting serious.
We're at the Lucha Dragons had to be split up into two matches level.
Pretty much. So here's the thing. What can be done? That's simple. My big question. What can be done to curb the amount of injuries that we seem to be getting this whole year in WWE? What can be done?
I got something, Eamon.
Dad, help us, Mike. Tell us what can be done. We need help.
Well, a couple things.
Mad Mike from Poughkeepsie, New York, by the way, joining us on the line.
I will just do one thing because we have a lot of people in here to answer, and I'm sure there will be some overlap. I will say better stories.
What?
And you're probably asking, how do better stories help injuries? Well, you see, if you actually write fucking stories, you don't have to rely on your in-ring product as much as you do.
That's
look at the Attitude Era.
That's a good
point. No match went longer than 10 minutes.
That's a really good
point.
None
of them. Mm-hmm. None of them. Stone Cold Steve Austin won the Intercontinental Championship at SummerSlam with a broken fucking neck that had to be fused and yet was still on the show every week as the hottest thing, and he didn't wrestle once. He mm-hmm. did promos. He maybe hit a stunner on Vince. Maybe, but he usually just swung a chair.
if you have stories and promos and in-ring segments and vignettes and backstage segments, guess what? You don't have to have AJ Styles and Kevin Owens do an almost 35-minute match at the start of Raw.
That's true.
Not that that's a bad thing, but you don't have to do it every week.
Yeah.
If you have more promos and better stories, you can push feuds without in-ring action. Look at Lucha Underground. I have never seen Matanza Cueto. He is my favorite character on the show. He has physically not been in the temple. That's the power of story. That is the power of storytelling.
The closest thing way he can get could have possibly ever gotten injured is if he ate a meal too fast, and by meal I mean person.
let me for mine just kind of take from that, because again I just had WWE Network on today and they were doing the Monday Night Wars on Mick Foley, and they talked about the famous interview they did with Mankind that kind of turned him face and talked about his upbringing and everything that led to the Dude Love videos and everything, right? They mentioned that those vignettes, those interviews, lasted 5 weeks on Raw. 5 weeks.
Mm-hmm. That's an entire WrestleMania build.
Yeah, I don't think it led to a direct feud or anything that I recall. It was just, hey, here's
no,
this
it
about
did.
This character.
It Sorg, did. It absolutely did.
Who did that lead to?
The return of Cactus Jack against Triple H.
Okay, that led directly to that eventually, but I thought that was...
Oh, you mean the sit down JR?
Sit down with JR, they talk about...
Oh, okay, no, that didn't lead... to anything specifically.
No, that was just like kind of a character piece.
Actually,
right?
No, it led to the creation of Dude Love.
Of course.
On WWE
course.
TV.
Right.
That's what it did, because that's where they initially talked about it. And Foley came out as the corporate guy and attacked Austin
right.
as Dude Love.
Right, exactly. So, but just thinking about that, you know, like they did that and that was something consistent versus then we have, well, and this is not something that leads to injuries, but like doesn't it seem like this R-Truth Goldust thing has been so odd and blink if you missed it in the mix of things in the long run versus something like that, that they paid attention to something like that and so much other stuff that they would have done, you know. It's like even now I think some of the greatest stuff they've been doing is Dean Ambrose out on the town. You know, has been a lot of fun. Him in Cincinnati was great.
I don't know
great.
Why they can't book everyone like Brock Lesnar or Dean Ambrose.
Right, exactly.
Brock Lesnar does not have to show up on screen for 6 months. And if you do a promo or an interview with him where he's talking about blood and sweat and urine, everyone's going to be interested in Brock Lesnar.
Exactly. Well, I want to get around
Bobby
here so we
Obama.
Can get everybody in here and yes. not go too long. Bobby, I just heard you say something. Do you have an answer here? How are we going to solve problems?
I do,
WWE.
But I want to take issue with something you said at the beginning of this by letting the floodgates open. That hurts. Sword.
Oh, I'm sorry. Bobby FJ Town from Floodtown, USA in Johnstown, PA.
Wow. Bobby's very flood intolerant.
I think they should not necessarily have an off-season, but at least start rotating guys out. Like,
right.
have guys have an allotted time off. Like, you get a three-month break. You get, you know. And it'll keep things fresher, I think, too, with certain people. Just an idea.
I'm with the rotation idea. I've been liking that idea for a while. Mm-hmm. I think it should be, like, almost become a corporate's HR policy that you get, like, 2 months off in the year, at least.
Well, it's like that interview with The Miz where he was like, I kind of hope I get injured or a movie, because you get time off and you get that big pop when you come back.
Exactly. And you can retool in the off season, right? Instead of being in part of the grind. It's just something about that. I'm sure you guys have been this where you've been at a job for so long and just getting a different job is a big refresher for you, right? I think that happens here too, because there's no other job to get at this point.
Plus, you can write somebody off TV easily.
Right, exactly, just like they do on TV.
But with that, I'm sorry to interrupt. But with that, you have to have a plan B, like in place, that quick. You can't just have a freak injury happen like
you can plan for
Harper.
It.
Right.
What was that?
You can plan for the person to be out. Like, you're gonna say, well, you won't have this guy for the next 3 months because he's gonna take a break.
Okay, the plan, yeah. I like that idea. I like the plan being, you know, just get them out, make them happy, get them the three. Like, 3 months seems like a long time, though.
Mm-hmm. Maybe two months.
Two and a half.
I was just thinking like summer break.
Right.
On those lines.
Exactly.
So, kind of like a school break.
Right. Yeah, so Riz, do you have an answer to the big question?
So the big question, can I get a repeat of the big question?
Oh, what can you do? What can we do to keep these injuries from happening in WWE?
You can't hide the injuries. Mm-hmm. You can't say you have an injury anymore. You don't have an injury anymore because everybody can see it. Everybody can tweet about it. Everybody can Facebook it. You're not going to have anybody doing anything. You can't say you don't have an injury to have an injury, but you can't. You just can't. You can't prevent injuries like this. You can't prevent John Cena's nose busted open. You can't predict Sin Cara's finger or hand breaking off into five places. You can't predict Luke Harper breaking a leg. You can't predict Sid's ankle snapping in two. You can't predict any of that. What?
I just said,
Yeah.
I don't know. I think you can predict Sin Cara getting injured, though.
It's
usually about every 3.5 months.
Original Sin Cara.
Riz, as sort of a side question to that question and response. So, do you feel that there is anything that is correlating to the amount of injuries we have been seeing recently? Do you think it's just a case of chance?
Honestly, it's the high risk that is increasing in WWE. Like before, we had little to no over-the-top rope action. We didn't have anybody doing planchas over the top rope or anything like that. We had matches in the ring, which featured submission specialists. The only injury I remember, probably not even an injury, but there wasn't really any major injuries like we're having now because many of the people in the Attitude Era kept on the ground.
Mm-hmm.
Like now we see people having like all these moves up in the air doing flips and shit.
To be fair, Mark.
And it's nice to see that. I love seeing that. But to say that it's not like those high risk moves aren't high risk is just blurting out nothing.
Mm-hmm. I kind of blame the fans, though, for that, because look how that one match last night, and yes, it was Philadelphia, but did you notice, I mean, it was a typical on-the-ground match, and they were sitting
Nobody
there going,
cared.
This
yeah.
is boring.
Mm-hmm.
And I Nobody blame cared. The fans and, for that. They don't care really about the wrestlers. They want to see, like you said, their high spots.
And this is what happens with stuff like I'm going to bring up football, like football and basketball. They don't want to see people take 3-point shots all the time. They want to see that dunk. They want to see that big hit. They want to see that amazing catch. But with that risk or with that reward comes the risk of having injuries like this. Mm-hmm. And yes, it's going to put on a good show, but you're taking a whole bunch of risks doing that. Like what if somebody lands on their head and breaks their neck.
Yeah.
Like they're Tyson Kidd right now has staples in his neck probably still from a muscle buster that he took. So you can't really do anything to prevent it, but you're going to lose viewers if you stop doing that.
Right, exactly.
You can't really blame the style of wrestling because we see that style of wrestling in Ring of Honor in Japan and Mexico and everywhere, and people are not getting injured at the rate that they're getting injured in WWE.
They're doing it a whole lot more in WWE, though. You got the house shows, you got SmackDown,
right.
You got Raw, you got the pay-per-views.
It's the grind.
You, You work a whole schedule. That's the thing. Like with
work over 290 days a year.
Right.
Yeah. You can cut that down.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. All right. Yeah. I want to make sure we go.
Honestly, I agree with what Mike said. If you, it happens even on the indies. Sorg, you've seen it. Eamon, you've seen it.
Yeah.
If you tell a good story, you don't need your little high flying acts and everything. You get more of a story that crowd's into. They're not worried about Jimmy, Joey, and Pete flying out the ring onto each other.
Yeah, and I think that's the. I'd argue with like the stuff with like last night with the This Is Warring Champs aren't really because like they weren't doing like giant high spots or like moonsaults or anything like that. I think it was more from a fact that it was a boring story because we've seen like Dean Ambrose and Braun Strowman is not a compelling story really. I think more than them not doing flashy wrestling moves.
Yeah, I think it was a little bit like it was the main event and we're like, this is it, really? Like this is what we're doing?
Yeah.
So, okay, all right. Who hasn't gone yet? Garza, did you officially give an answer?
No, I haven't. Since we already talked about like the wrestling style and stuff, I think we also need to look at the training style. I think something that was going around at the start of the year when Cena and Orton and Sami Zayn was being injured, Cesaro being injured, all of the shoulder, they were blaming a lot the style of training. They're doing like Olympic lifting, and you're putting all that pressure on your body, and then going in and do all the wrestling. So it's there's something in there, you know, that they need to have like smarter training, because I mean you do have a performance center where you should have like professional people tell you if you're doing something correct or wrong. So I think they need to look also into that, like the training.
Right. Matt Carlins is with us as well. He's madly preparing, of course, for Mayhem Mania tonight. But do you have the big question? Oh no, there's something in a bowl.
Yeah. I love the idea of less house shows, less dives to the outside. How about no more dark matches? I think we've reached the point where the dark match is a useless contraption to put at the end of your 3.5 damn hour wrestling taping on a Monday night. If your 6-man tag is that awesome, put it on TV. If not, don't do it. No more dark matches.
You know what you could do? Guess what? What they used to do. A dark segment. A dark in-ring segment.
It would just be like, well, the Austin would drink beers for
Austin
20 minutes.
The Austin Beer
yeah.
Bash, the yeah. Rock sing-along, something.
Dean Ambrose saws things in half with Terry Funk's chainsaw for 20 minutes. It'd be great fun. It'd be like a Gallagher show.
Exactly.
But you don't know how many episodes of Raw that I watched when I logged stuff at WWE that just ended with Steve Austin proposing to Lillian Garcia. I'm not joking. I'm literally not joking. Like, I saw at least 5 or 6 Raws in a row where he would just end up proposing marriage to Lillian Garcia.
Mm-hmm.
You can bring in JBL and have him do a Texas two-step for fuck's sake.
There you go.
You can do whatever you want at the end of the show, but no, you choose to do a bullshit 8-man tag, 6-man tag, 10-man tag, whatever. Just another chance for your talent to get injured.
Yeah.
Instead of maybe do something to push their characters.
Right.
Or just have fun
and give the audience something to go with. The best thing, the After Raw DVD. Like, the best stuff wasn't matches they had. It was the goofy stuff. Or Stone Cold having a 20-minute beer, you know, party, you know, for no reason.
Beer parties are my favorite parties.
Like some of the greatest stuff about wrestling doesn't involve wrestling, and that's what you can end the night on, you know? Or you know, John Cena coming out and you know, getting personal with Pittsburgh over something or something, you know? Or you know, the Kane Spinner-Rooney segments or you know, weird stuff that they won't do in the context of, let's say, canon on Raw, right? But you can do, and I think it's more important as a fan going to Raw and saying, oh man, I remember this one time when they talked Kane into doing the Spinneroonie, and it was crazy. You'd never see that on TV. And more than I can't tell you something memorable from any dark match that I've seen since I've been going. You know,
that one guy hit his finisher. Cool.
Yeah, like oh, you got a street fight.
Oh, the faces went over. Wow, that was
weird.
Awesome.
They did a match to a half empty arena because I don't know if it's like this for you guys, but everybody leaves to beat the traffic. You know, during the match when John Cena comes out, right? So, anyways, anybody else have an answer to the question? We do have to get on to the Mayhem Mania here. Bueller?
Did everybody go?
Everybody?
I think we did.
Everybody chimed in. All right. Here we go. It's time.
Here we are.
It's time.
Jesus, take the wheel.
Carlin's take the wheel.
Carlin's take the wheel.
Carlin's take the wheel.
Drive it off the cliff, please.
This is the final round of Mayhem Mania. We filled up our supercard last week during Patreon in the Bank. So we're working on the undercard. These 8 matches we'll make changes to. Then we'll have a vote on the Facebook page, the Wrestling Mayhem Show Facebook page, and we will vote one of the eight matches to be in the pre-show of Mayhem Mania. What an honor. And the rest of these losers go into the Battle Royal. And we're going to go 7 deep. I want to tell you guys all that the first of all, there was a big bushel of eliminators last week because a bunch of matches graduated. So I just want to mention of those who are in attendance. Bobby, you have 2 eliminators. Garza, you have 1. And Sorg, I thought you had 1 too, right?
Sorg, I still have one.
Sorg is one that he hasn't used.
Sorg has 1 that he hasn't used. So you guys think about whether or not you want to eliminate anybody while I tell you the rest of the stuff that's going to go on.
Who has been eliminated so far?
Ken Anderson.
Only 1 man.
Does Anderson?
Mr. Anderson. I thought you were setting us up to do
I was just
Mr.
making
Anderson.
Sure.
Mr. Anderson. Yeah.
Can we use an eliminator at any point tonight?
You can use it at any point, but you can't eliminate someone who's on the card.
Once they go off the card,
leave Mad Mike's lips, it's too late for you to say, oh, wait, God, no, I wanted to eliminate David Arquette. It's too damn late.
Once they go off the card, though, you can.
Yeah, once they're off the card, then you can. The Alex Cars rules is in effect from last week. Unfortunately, it applies to Cars and it applies to Ed, and neither of them are here. So neither of them get to go in last. But... Stop laughing. I'm trying to tell everybody what's going on.
I'm not laughing,
so, the Alex Cora's rules is in effect, but they aren't here to go last, but they can't take advantage of handing out the punishment. So I asked Cars and Ed who they wanted to be punished this week. Alex Cars wants to punish Eamon. Ed
of
wants to punish Mad Mike. So, good news, boys. The punishment this week is the Jar of the Unloved. There's about 13 or 14 guys on the WWE main roster whose names have yet to be uttered during Mayhem Mania this year. They're in this jar. So when it comes to your turn, I will draw a name, and you will be forced to use one of those losers. Oh. Now, Wheels, you're up first. Riz is on deck. And I will recap the 8 matches on the undercard while Riz or Wheels thinks about what's he going to do.
All right.
Darren Young versus Michael Tarver. Alberto Del Rio versus Austin Aries. I believe this is a Kennel from Hell match. Eva Marie versus Lana. Sasha Banks versus Becky Lynch. El Torito versus Hornswoggle. Ladder match for the Divas title. Paige versus Asuka versus Charlotte versus Bayley. Chris Jericho versus Dolph Ziggler. And, of course, Snooki, David Arquette, and Kevin Federline versus Ronda Rousey, Stephen Amell, and... Carl Malone.
Oh, man.
The best match ever.
Let's ask Garza if it's the best match ever.
Garza. It's the best Photoshop ever.
The match graphic, I have to say. I think it's some of your finest.
I gotta say, the match graphic was below the bar, Garza.
It's no Luke Harper in a suit.
Honestly, the only better match graphic you have done for Mayhem Mania is when you had to put Hornswoggle in the match and it was just the top of his head.
Ooh.
That's amazing. That's absolutely amazing. Mr. Wheels.
Oh, Wheels, who's your favorite wrestler? I'm going to try to help you.
Well, my favorite wrestler... I'm looking at a match right now and
I have a question for it.
All right.
The Titus O'Neil thing, is that affected since days. He's suspended?
Nope. Yeah, it's true. Everyone comes in their current emotional, physical, contractual, and suspendable condition. So, yes, Titus O'Neil is suspended. So, I'm sorry. He can't play.
Okay. Just was making sure of that.
Good question.
Thank you. Thank you. So, I'm going to add a person into the Kennel from Hell match with Tarver and Darren Young.
Oh, God.
I don't think that's...
this is actually Del Rio versus Aries is the Kennel from Hell, but please, feel free. Go in alone on Darren Young and the Michael Tarver match. This needs
to happen. I'm going to add to that. Though, I'm going to make it Darren Young versus Michael Tarver versus R-Truth.
Very nice.
Battle of the Brothers.
was that made. Someone that was in the Unloved bin, Matt?
We'll see. If I draw the name, then you'll know.
Okay.
So, I made it easy for you there, Garza. So,
yeah, that's an easy one.
Yeah, so there you go.
I'm just... Very nice. Riz, thanks. You're up. Sorgatron, you're on deck.
Oh, no.
I'm looking at this this awesome celebrity match.
You thinking what I'm thinking?
Adding to it, right? Adding to it.
I'm gonna take out Ronda Rousey because she can fight.
Ooh. Just Ronda?
Just Ronda.
Guess what?
I love it.
Guess what? It's time to use one of my eliminators. She's gone.
Oh,
hey, Bobby, Bobby, that is a waste. That is a waste, Bobby.
Come on.
Hey, I still have
a UFC.
That is a waste.
Six other celebrities, Bobby, and you use it on Ronda Rousey, the one who can actually work. All right.
Uh-huh.
All right, let's go on.
She's gone.
She's gone.
I see Bobby, you have gone. One eliminator.
Add to this celebrity. Six-man tag match.
Come on, are you minimus?
I am adding.
Betty White. Betty
Todd White. Chrisley.
Todd Chrisley. Oh, no!
I like it.
Thank you.
Blast.
Are you spelling out Chrisley?
On blast.
Oh.
Now, are you... Wait, hold on. Matt, can we have an official ruling?
Hey, no. I'm alone.
No,
is
I have
on
a question.
This...
I have Riz.
Let me tell you something. Let me tell you something. My stand on celebrities.
Natty and Todd Chrisley are the same person. Natty is already booked.
Oh
no!
Oh,
that's evil.
It was a question. I'm just looking for clarification.
Chrisley and Natty are the same person.
Hey guys, I don't know if you know this. Commercials aren't real.
Yeah. So fuck you, Todd Chrisley.
Damon, neither is wrestling.
Oh, well.
Oh, shit.
Let's go. Sorgatron, you're up, Garza. You're on deck.
I'm going to make it easy. Can you add blue pants to the Eva Marie and Lana match?
The spank bait match?
Whoa! Sorry.
That's the Becky Sasha match.
I was going to say, that's the Hornswoggle match.
Because it's sponsored by Sunnyside Up.
Can I add a sponsor? Is that can I put that out there? Is that
you add sponsor?
Chance. Oh, it's a sponsor. You should have ponied up on Patreon last week.
I really felt.
You made it on Patreon?
I don't think I could Patreon my own. Okay. Well, I guess I could. No, that wouldn't work.
My hand reaching for this. Oh, thanks. Oh, good.
You know what, Matt? As a Patreon, I say swords aloud.
Sorg, who do you want to sponsor this cosplay match between Eva Marie and Lana?
I think it would only make sense that it would be sponsored by Silk Stockings on USA.
What?
I don't know.
Brand old school. Everything gets a reboot.
I have no idea what you're talking about.
No.
Aim it. Just look up Ronda Shears Up All Night and just go down that rabbit hole.
Yeah,
I'm good.
Gilbert Godfrey.
Nobody wants to go down that hole.
We don't have to do that.
Garza, you're up. Mad Mike, you're on deck.
Okay, so, I'm looking at the roster right now to see who's left. I'm going to destroy that Torito Hornswoggle match.
Okay.
With fire.
And just randomly going to add, let's see.
Hold on. I want to use my eliminator on Torito.
To read out?
Yes. Okay. I'm done with it.
You're doing the good Lord's work right
I,
now.
That is the makeup for my accidental slight against Garza. I just want to get rid of bad Mexican stereotypes. and he's gone. He's gone.
Who feels better? I feel better.
I feel better. You know. That's my make good. I hope we're even now, Garza.
Thank you. Thank you. All right. So let's replace it with a four-way. I have Alex Riley.
Oh, God, no.
I have Damian Sandow. I have Fandango. And Wade Barrett. Those are four pictures that I want to use.
That's probably most of that.
Wade Barrett is always hurt, but continues to work. Therefore, he can stand on the apron and do what he always does. Mm-hmm. Absolutely nothing.
And then, boom!
WrestleMania match. So
that's true. Where are we? Oh, it's time for Mad Mike. It's time for Mad Mike. Bobby, you're on deck. Man, Mike, if I happen to draw someone who's in Garza's four-way match, we will draw another name.
Sounds good.
Oh, I wanted to tell you, too, there are also a couple tag teams in here.
Please.
Let's Jack see Swagger. The jar
Jack
of the
Swagger. Please, Jack
Swagger. Let's see. Oh, hell yeah. You got Eric Rowan. Good job, Tiger. You got the last healthy Wyatt. Good job. Here we go.
All right. All right. Eric Rowan.
Wait. One sec. What did they call Owen Hart when Brett left? Like the last Hart or something?
Nugget?
The Black Heart?
The Black Heart, right? So he's like... No, that doesn't.
Black no, no, Wyatt. Do not say he's the Black Wyatt. That doesn't.
Right. He can't be the Black Sheep either.
Yeah.
There's
got to be something. There's got to be a last man standing Wyatt something phrase we can use there for him. I'm sorry, Mike. Go ahead.
Okay, so I have to add Eric Rowan. fuck.
That you got this six man celebrity match.
And man, hope he doesn't get hurt next week.
Oh, no, that's perfect the way it is.
Yeah, it's perfect. Shut your mouth. That is perfect.
That is perfect.
I know exactly where I would hit Eric Rowan, and I hope Mike's feeling the same way.
I'm
curious. No.
Me too. I kind of want to know Eamon's idea, because I have no fucking idea what to do.
Please go help for the studio audience.
Is it a four-way match?
All right, you know what? Eric Rowan.
Oh, I knew which one you were picking, Amy.
Damn it, because I had an idea and I was hoping I'd get Jack Swagger for this. But you know what? All right, fuck it.
Just use Jack Swagger too.
Is Braun Strowman injured?
No.
Okay, here's what we are doing. That Battle of the Brothers, that's
gone. Oh, my.
That's gone.
Wait, which Battle of the Brothers?
Darren Young versus Michael Tarver's Archer. Fuck that.
Oh, God.
That's racist.
Fuck that. Michael Tarver is not being a part of this vote.
Damn.
Thank you.
Thanks, Mike.
Thank you.
What we are going to do, Matt Carlins, is we are going to have the Wyatt family versus Team Canada. Bobby Roode and Eric Young versus Eric Rowan and Braun Strowman.
No Petey Williams?
Isn't he retired?
No Petey Williams.
I think he's retired.
There is not a third Wyatt member to pair him with.
I say yes.
Why wouldn't we? It looks fine to me.
I like it. I actually like it.
Objections? Good. Okay. Where are we now? Bobby, you're up. Eamon, you're on deck with the jar of the unloved.
I don't know what to do.
Oh, Bobby, you got so many choices. Bobby, who's your favorite wrestler?
It's not injured.
That's a different podcast.
That's a different podcast.
It's a simple question. It's not trademarked.
Mike took out the match I was going to take out.
What?
Mike took out the match I was going to take out.
Take out his match. I don't know. You know, it's not like he can come back and hurt you. There's no tomorrow.
Punishments anymore, huh?
There's no more punishment. You can do whatever you want.
Take off the abomination of that celebrity match.
Oh, Okay.
Bobby.
You know what?
I hope you and walk to Pittsburgh.
Since I'm at it, I'm going to use my other eliminator on David Arquette.
I got to use my eliminator.
There's only one person left, like in all of Mayhem Media.
Did I hear Stephen Amell? Stephen Amell?
No,
David
Arquette. Eamon, you should book every other celebrity just to piss
off. Did you use your eliminator too?
Jumping in. Oh, I got somebody. Okay. I Garza eliminated Stephen Amell. And Bobby just eliminated David Arquette. Blinked out of existence.
With killing that match, I'm going to create a match.
What's causing all this?
The Undertaker's not on the card yet, correct?
That's right.
The Undertaker.
This is last WrestleMania.
The Undertaker versus Baron Corbin in a Dude, Where's My Bike match.
Oh,
that's a father versus son match if you
want to. Older Wolf.
That's what we're going with there.
Oh, man. I love it. Good work, Bobby. Good work, Bobby.
We've gone from the first week, Undertaker versus Samoa Joe, sponsored by Lucha Underground, to Undertaker versus Baron Corbin, sponsored by Harley Davidson.
Yeah. Sponsored by Chrisley Knows Best. Duh. All right.
Sorry. No, that was the celebrity match that we got rid of.
We made Chrisley the special guest referee.
Yes.
No.
Now cool your pies. All right. Let's see. All right, Eamon, let's see what lucky bastard
Bobby,
you're going to
you were right about this, right?
Eamon! Oh, the cruelest slight of all. You got Jack Swagger.
Damn it! I want Jack Swagger!
Eamon's nodding. I can work with this.
Eamon?
I have no idea.
Replace the Wyatts with Swagger and Angle.
No! Fuck no!
Oh, that's a great idea! Canada versus the USA, it has
exactly.
To happen.
Exactly!
All right,
Texas.
All right, compromise.
You know,
I have an irrational dislike for Angle. Let's team up Henry and Swagger to defend America.
No,
failures that they are.
Shit.
Let Eamon go.
Shut your mouth.
Let's see. What match would I take off? I don't want to piss anyone off.
Eamon.
I don't see why.
Eamon. You don't want to piss anybody off.
We are so close to an undercard that's better than the supercard right now.
If I just take off
one more good match.
How about this? If I take off Del Rio and Aries, no one's going to be mad, right?
No, but you will be booking a new Kennel from Hell match.
Stipulation?
Yeah,
that's of course it does.
Oh, fuck.
I can't get rid of that. Patreon paid for that.
Jack Swagger like dogs.
I have a feeling Swagger can make it work.
Who made the Alex Riley one again?
I did.
Do you care if I take that match off?
That's work for me. I guess not.
the match I made is going to be much easier.
Eamon chooses the last move to start being civil to someone.
You son of a bitch, you're taking Wade Barrett off this card? This is last WrestleMania. What are you doing?
Yeah, that match can go. Also, because Alex Riley has shitty things to say about stuff on Twitter, and I'm not happy. But I'm going to go with Jack Swagger one-on-one with Chad Gable.
Ooh. Chad Gable's already on the card.
Chad Gable is already booked.
Oh, fuck, he is.
That's why I said Angle.
No.
He's right there.
Fuck.
There must be some other amateur wrestler we can put in this match.
Must love dogs. Yeah. You know what? Fine, then Jack Swagger versus Wade Barrett, so I'll make Matt happy.
You cannot do that. Who's the guy that you're taking the match?
Oh, my God. I hate this game.
Eamon.
I am in a pickle.
You know what to do, Eamon.
This match, this game has so little rules, yet so many rules.
Eamon, if you're feeling desperate, I can always draw another name.
What the fuck? I wanted Swagger and I couldn't draw another name?
No, I'm telling you that if you can't think of a good opponent for Swagger, I will just draw a name for you.
I couldn't think of a good opponent for Rowan. That's bullshit.
Yeah, no, that's fine.
He has to use Swagger.
All right, you got a good point. Eamon, you're stuck with it. I'm not helping. You get yourself out of this mess.
Fucking hell.
Find somebody to fight Swagger.
Do it.
Just add Swagger to the Eva Marie and Lana and Blue Pants match.
No. Matt,
who's your favorite? Who's your favorite female wrestler?
Matt, just pull out some of the more names so I can think of people to put against Swagger. Like, I'll put him against somebody else in the bowl. Like,
How about Shane McMahon?
I'm going to start reading you NXT names here if you don't start talking.
That's fine.
Great call.
Yeah. Oh, update to the latest version. I'm sorry. My WWE app isn't working, Amon. I'm sorry. You're stuck, buddy. You have to come up with something on your own.
Okay, fine. Since you're not going to draw more names for me to see, I'll say Jack Swagger. I'll go with Tonios. Jack Swagger and Tommaso Ciampa. Sure, why not? Fuck it.
All right.
I'm not passionate about it, but I'm fine with it.
Is that your final answer?
Yeah, that's my final answer.
Ended with a whimper and a whine.
He did whimper and whine. Hey, that's what punishment's all about. But you know what, Eamon? Don't be sad. You dominated this Mayhem Mania this year. You were running this thing for a good 3 or 4 weeks. And basically, once you took all your moves and sat off for a little bit, this card went to hell. But anyway, here's the undercard. And we'll have a poll on Wrestling Mayhem Show Facebook group. And one of these matches will get to be on the pre-show. And the rest of these fools will be in the Battle Royal. So the matches are... Bobby Roode and Eric Young versus Eric Rowan and Braun Strowman. Alberto Del Rio versus Austin Aries. Eva Marie versus Lana versus Blue Pants. Sasha Banks versus Becky Lynch. Jack Swagger versus Tommaso Ciampa. Paige versus Asuka versus Charlotte versus Bayley. Chris Jericho versus Dolph Ziggler. And The Undertaker versus Baron Corbin. A great match. It is a great match. It's going to be fantastic. The best match.
I mean, that celebrity match was pretty good,
so
too,
good.
But fucking no. Bobby had to ruin it.
I'm surprised that celebrity match lasted as long as it did.
Chrisley made that match the best match on that list.
I guess I'm on black.
The best match on that list.
Well, Bobby, you're
it is amazing how
black.
Changing one person made all the difference in that
match. Well, you guys can have the breakdown. You guys can have Talking Mayhem Mania later on the Google Hangout if you like, but we need to answer the question. I almost said the question from the other podcast you guys keep quoting, but what did you learn from wrestling this week?
I don't know what you're talking about.
So who's your favorite wrestler?
Fuck you.
Do
what did you learn from wrestling this week, guys? How about you, Bobby FJ Town?
What I learned ties into what I learned last week. I learned that Ryback was dropped from his hot dog sponsorship.
Aww.
He was nowhere to be found last night.
Aww.
And that made me happy because I hate Ryback.
Well, we all know Pennsylvania, Philly isn't known for their hot dogs. That's probably why.
There's that. Eamon, what'd you learn from wrestling this week?
I learned from wrestling this week that we can't always have nice things.
Mm-mm.
And sometimes we have to have a nice thing covered in Sin Cara and Zack Ryder.
What? All right. There's that too.
Clown in here?
You know when I was watching all those the stuff in Ring of Honor with Kevin Cena and El Generico and all those great stuff, with Kevin Owens and Sami Zayn and NXT and the great story they feel. You know what I thought? You know what this needs? Sin Cara and Zack Ryder.
Matt Carlins, what'd you learn from wrestling this week?
I learned that Terry Funk is sad because he never had a son. But Dean Ambrose will do just fine.
And since you were the other one in the Facebook, Jennifer from the Facebook says that Kane still got it. Okay.
Got
all right.
Kane!
Kane! He's got something going on. What about you, Mr. Wheels?
What have I learned from wrestling? I learned that 3 hours and maybe 20 minutes of Raw is just too much for me. I can live with just answering your question from the wrap-up. How many hours of Raw did I enjoy? AJ Styles and Kevin Owens. That's it. There.
However long that was, the three segments that was, right? Mad Mike?
Yeah, I...
Oh, sorry.
That's it.
Mad Mike?
That's okay.
What'd you learn?
Oh, what did I learned... that we've had a year and a half build up to see what Batanza Cueto looks like, and fuck, it did not disappoint, and I can't wait to see him in Aztec Warfare.
Shit, I need to catch up. Shit.
Yeah, you do, Sorg.
Shit, I need to catch up.
Sorg, I put this above Daredevil, and you know how much I fucking love Daredevil. I don't have
time for any. Okay, listen, man. I got time to watch shows that I can put on while I'm working. Lucha and Daredevil are two things I want to pay attention to. That's why they haven't been watched. Because like, I respect Lucha Underground to try to watch it while I'm editing or doing a podcast or whatever the case may be. I respect it too damn much. It needs the time it deserves. That's what Easter is going to be for. What about you, Antonio Garza?
I learned dreams come true. That the Phoenix Rises and the Man in the Throne have been killed.
Wait, what?
Lucha Underground stuff.
Okay, all right. Because I thought you just spoiled Mad Men for me or something, but okay. Because I half cut.
Better Game of Thrones.
Oh, shit, what'd I learn?
Yes.
Sorg.
Hey, Sorg, what'd you learn?
Sorg, who's your favorite wrestler?
Shut up! Shut up! Shut up!
Sorg?
Yes.
Sorg, I think you forgot to ask Riz.
Oh,
hold on.
No, it's fine. It's fine.
From the.
Sorry, Riz, who's your favorite wrestler?
I'm sorry. I'm sorry. There is like an auditorium of people in here I can't keep track of. Riz.
Yes.
What'd you learn?
I learned that. Terry Bollea had to give Hulk Hogan had to give Terry Bollea $25 million just because he said his dick is bigger than Terry Bollea's.
That's true.
Running wild.
It's complicated.
In the meantime, I learned that my library carries all of the WWE films. And I'm going to be watching 12 Rounds 2 with Randy Orton sometime this week.
Sorg.
Why are you going to punish yourself like that?
I want to see him. I didn't say you have time. Listen, okay, wait. You know how I said about Lucha Underground and Daredevil I respect and want to give the time to, and I'm not going to do it while I'm working on other things?
Yes.
Guess what I'm watching while I'm finishing off the Prime Wrestling DVDs tomorrow?
Makes sense.
All right.
So you start with See No Evil.
I love See No Evil.
You go to Condemned.
I would also watch See
Done.
No Evil 2.
And then See No Evil 2.
See No Evil 2. No, I need to, I want to see the Ambrose, Dean Ambrose
stop.
Movie. And I mean, listen, okay, here's what I'll do. I'll watch the Randy Orton 12 rounds, and then I'll also hit myself in the head with this kendo stick, and I'll see which one hurts worse.
Then you take it to the papers.
And yeah. Take it to the paper.
Only if you have to. Only if you have to.
Only if
or
you have
call
to.
The cops because they're going to hear me.
And then you watch that weird John Cena wrestling, amateur wrestling movie.
Legendary. Legendary was not a half bad movie. No, I've seen a lot of. I've seen a lot
with
of the
Danny
films.
Danny Glover.
Just,
and then you tune into Fox to see American Grit starring John Cena.
Did I see The Marine in the theater?
And then Fox News has Bulls and Bears with JBL.
Mm-hmm. Naturally,
Bulls and Bears.
And then you watch Fly Fishing with Eric Young and Outdoor Adventure with Shawn Michaels.
Oh, and then you
those are not the names of those shows.
Riz.
And you wonder what life is all about.
Riz.
Sorg.
I love you.
I love you too, Sorg.
And all the Mayhemers that join me tonight, Riz is at Riz Plays Games. Hot Wheels is at Hot Wheels RWA. Antonio Garza is the W Revolution on the Twitters. Also with us at Mainstream Matt 1T, at Mad Mike 4883, at Bobby F J Town, at Amon 2, please. Did I miss any squares down there? Anybody? Bueller? Thank you so much, everybody, for joining us.
Phyllis Diller.
I'm at Sorgatron. Wrestling Mayhem Show is the place. Go check us out, WrestlingMayhemShow.com. Click on all the things. Thank you to our, I believe Matt and Mike was live tweeting tonight.
I stopped for Mayhem Mania, though, because I had to focus.
Well, there's that. There's priorities. I think I kicked a couple out there during that. Missy, for helping with show notes and graphics, of course, as usual. And, of course, live.wrestlingmayhemshow.com, 9 p.m. Eastern Time. Check out the Indie Mayhem Show. Great interviews all through the weeks, talking with guys like Shane Taylor, Ray Rowe, Jimmy Corderas, DJ Zima Ion. Who else? Chris the Joseph of Lucha Underground. and so many more, 111 episodes in the can so far. And we got another great one coming up here tonight from Eamon's Neck Dealers. And I just sent an email. Actually, just sent an email to try to book somebody else here during the show. So looking forward to that, too. Got my kabuki stick. We'll see you guys next time. Mayhem out. This show is a member of the Sorgatron Media Podcast Network. Find out more at sorgatronmedia.com.
Guys are cool.
Hey, Daniel Perry again. Hey, I know you guys got a live stream coming up a little bit later on tonight, but I just want to tell you what I've learned from wrestling this week. Sami Zayn will be the next Daniel Bryan, and Ryback will be the next CM Punk. You ever watch the footage from between Ryback and Curtis Axel? You'll see what I mean. All right, guys. Well, hope you guys have a good day, and I'll look at your recap on Wednesday. Take care. Bye.